Thank you everybody for coming along to our webinar. We're very excited about our book. We're going to introduce ourselves a little bit, but I guess that we also want to talk a little bit about the book. I'm a senior lecturer in social psychology at the University of the West of England in Bristol in the UK. And my own research interests are largely focused around sexuality. So I'm interested in particular in bisexuality and pansexuality, as well as some other topics. I'll let Gareth introduce himself as well.
Hi everyone, I'm Gareth Terry. I'm a senior lecturer in rehabilitation studies at the Auckland University of Technology. I do work that's informed by critical health psychology and post-critical rehabilitation studies, and largely doing work that explores rehabilitation, disability and access amongst a number of other things, but interested broadly in the intersection of gender, bodies and health.
Okay, great. Thanks, Gareth. And so both Gareth and I were introduced to thematic analysis through our undergraduate and PhD studies. And Gareth was supervised by Jeannie Brown, and I was supervised by Victoria Clark. And so we continue to work with them. And I guess it's relevant in terms of our grounding in thematic analysis. It comes very much from a Brown and Clark approach to TA, now known as reflexive thematic analysis. And we feel very fortunate to have been supported and supervised by Brown and Clark. So we just like to acknowledge that support that they've given us and the part that they've played in us coming to write a book about TA. And we had a number of aims when we wrote the book. We wanted to make it short, but clear and accessible. And we try to use lots of examples to really bring it to life. So what we'd like to do today is give a bit of an overview of thematic analysis and a bit of a taster of what the book's all about.
So why use thematic analysis, and particularly reflexive thematic analysis? It's worth noting here that our book and this webinar are discussing a particular type of thematic analysis. So these comments relate specifically to the reflexive version of TA. TA is incredibly useful for telling the story of a qualitative data set, and this is fundamentally what good qualitative and even quantitative analysis should be about. But unlike many analytic methods, TA was designed with this storytelling orientation. While some qualitative methods seem somewhat answerable to quantitative concerns, reflexive TA is a qualitative tool for qualitative analysis. If that's something that you're after, then our book could well be a good entry point in that regard. There's been a lot written about the method, and so the resources for supporting it are extensive. I would go as far as saying there's an information infrastructure around the method. Our book is one of a number of documents that talk about it, and it gives a short and easily digestible entry point, but you shouldn't stop there. There are websites and articles and book chapters and other books. Importantly, reflexive TA supports the building of craft skills that many qualitative approaches need for success. And as a consequence, it's a good place to start learning about qual work more generally. But that doesn't mean that it's not also useful for quite sophisticated and long-term use. Both Nikki and I continue to use it well into our careers. Last, the sheer popularity of Brown and Clark's 2006 paper suggests there's an appetite for this kind of method, although we're not completely convinced that many of the people who have cited the paper have actually read it. It seems to be meeting people's needs, though, or at least the kinds of things they think they're after. While we're going to give some tips about research design, we're not going to show you how to do a thematic analysis study, because there's no such thing. Tied to this is knowing what TA is supposed to do. It's a horizontal form of analysis for constructing patterns across a data set. It isn't designed for close reading of texts. If you want to do things like that, then this series has a number of texts that look at that type of analysis. So the conversation analysis text and the discursive psychology text, or even themes within interviews, which was where you might be doing EPA or IPA. There are a wide variety of approaches that this APA series gives you access to, and many of these involve talking through qualitative methodologies, which will often have things like theoretical framing and decisions about sampling and data collection set up in advance. In other words, the research design jigsaw puzzle comes pretty much set up. TA, though, is just about your analysis. It's one small part of the jigsaw puzzle. And it's for that reason that you can't do a thematic analysis study. You need all the other parts of the jigsaw to make it work well. And sometimes this will be with an existing methodology, like qualitative description or interpretive description, where there's scope to mix and match with various methods. But other times it'll be plugged into a research design where the researcher has built everything from the ground up. It's almost like they're building the jigsaw as they go, cutting and connecting the parts and shaping the jigsaw along the way. But either way, TA is just one part of that puzzle. It's an extremely flexible piece, and it can be used across a wide range of theoretical frameworks, a broad range of research questions, and a variety of data collection methods. But you have to figure out how these things might work together and to be able to articulate those connections. An important thing that we have to keep pushing as well is know the method you're using. Different analytical methods do different things. There are even different versions of thematic analysis. So the core values of reflexive thematic analysis is a little strange to talk about methods in terms of values, but these really just emphasize that reflexive TA was designed for a particular purpose, and these values are still important to the original design. This doesn't mean there's no room for evolution or development, there definitely is, but that evolution needs to remain tied to these values or it basically stops being what it was designed to be. The first one, theoretical flexibility, because it's just a method, it needs to be adaptable to a wide range of theoretical possibilities. This is fundamental to reflexive thematic analysis, forcing your method into fixedness through insisting on things like inter-rater reliability or as some sort of gold standard undermine this flexibility, and they certainly don't enhance its rigor or its outputs. On the flip side, identifying your theoretical position when doing a reflexive TA is crucial because of the variety of options that are possible. Second thing to raise is that it's rigorous, tested, and process focused. There's been an absolute swath of articles that have used reflexive TA, and many have even done it well. And this has demonstrated that the method helps facilitate good analysis, but this doesn't mean that everyone does it the same. The phases work to guide you, but are flexible, iterative, and recursive, and we talk about this a lot in the book. Process is just as important as the output in our minds, and engaging in the process and enjoying it. Overall, the phases and our book are there to provide a supportive framework to help you make sense of your data, and we show you what we do and tell you why. And this is based off years of experience, not just ours, but our mentors and their mentors. The next value to focus on is the emphasis on the reflexive contribution of the researcher. This is something that people often struggle with, but it's in the name, so I'm sorry, you can't avoid it. Who you are and your understanding of the topic you're studying is central to the analysis. You're not set up as some kind of objective automaton that spits out themes. You contribute, you interpret, you make sense, you make analytical decisions. And last, seeing themes as multifaceted conceptual meaning-based patterns. And I know that's a real mouthful, and we thoroughly unpack this in the book. But what you're producing are not simple summaries of the data with vague titles that don't tell you much. Instead, you're producing conceptually rich, thoughtful, engaged stories of your data set.
So one of the key areas of flexibility that comes with TA is in terms of the research questions that you can address using a thematic analysis of your data. And of course, the research question is central to qualitative research projects. So we develop it early and it informs the design of our studies. It's part of the package. And there are a couple of ways in which flexibility applies to research questions in thematic analysis. So first of all, TA is really appropriate to address a number of different types of research questions. These could be focused on people's experiences of a particular phenomenon. So for example, it could be aspects of people's lives or their identities. And one example on the slide here is a study by Attard and Coulson, and they use TA to explore users' experiences of online discussion forums about Parkinson's disease. But research questions can also be focused on people's perceptions or understandings. So Adam Jowett and Liz Peel use TA to consider LGBT people's perspectives on how their sexuality is relevant to their experience of living with a chronic illness. It's just taking a step further back from experience to thinking about people's perspectives of their experiences, but it could be perspectives of all kinds of things. And you might also move to thinking about how particular phenomena might be socially constructed. So we've got a study as an example here by Jane Usher on constructions of difficult and rewarding aspects of cancer care and how they're constructed in relation to gender. And of course, your research question needs to be created and developed within the context of what type of approach you're taking to your data. So your epistemological and ontological positions, as well as your method of data collection. And these all need to be suited to your TA project. The other area of flexibility with research questions is around the flexibility in being able to make changes to it. So as you develop your project and start to collect the data, particularly in the early phases, you might find that you want to make some tweaks to your research question. But of course, you still need to make sure it fits with your overall theoretical approach and choice of data collection. So even within these examples, there are variations in the data collection methods. So data for these studies were online discussion forums, qual surveys, and interviews. And this leads me nicely into talking about flexibility in terms of methods of data collection. And there is a great deal of flexibility in terms of what forms of data you might collect for your study or you might use for your study from existing data. So this ties in with the flexibility of your research question. And I often feel that I can't emphasize enough how important it is to ensure that you have a good fit across your research project. And this is a term that I'm borrowing or stealing from Carla Willig. This idea that because TA isn't a pre-arranged package, you don't have a set theory, a set method. So it's not like other analytic methods. You do need to make sure that you make choices and that you articulate those choices and that those choices are complementary to each other. So on this slide, I've just listed some of the common methods of data collection that you might choose to use with TA. So you might use interviews, and this isn't limited only to face-to-face in-person interviews. Skype and Zoom and video call interviews have all become much more popular since the pandemic, but they've been around for some time and hold a number of methodological advantages. There's also walking and talking interviews and all sorts of other forms of interviews that you can use. So if you're interested in a topic where your participant is really personally invested, then interviews can be a really suitable choice of data collection that give you those opportunities to prompt and to probe and really get to some of the depth and detail that you want for qualitative data. And you could also use something where you interview a group of people together, usually referred to as a focus group, where you want to encourage people to talk about the topic together. But you're not only limited to methods where you meet your participants in person, where you do face-to-face data collection, and there's a whole range of textual-based methods of data collection that you might find useful. So we're big advocates of these types of methods. They bring a whole range of potential advantages in terms of being resource light, not only for you, but also for your participants. So surveys might be perhaps the most recognized of these methods. And in these, you're involved in asking your participants a series of open-ended questions. These can be delivered in a range of formats. They can be done in hard copy, they can be done via email. Most commonly these days, we see people doing them on Qualtrics or SurveyMonkey and giving that bit of flexibility for how participants complete them. And there are some other methods that some may be less familiar with. So story-based methods, which we're also big fans of, they give you an element of creativity and they're really interesting methods to engage with. So things like story completion tasks, where you ask your participants to respond to a story stem or a story cue and to continue that story or write a fictional account. And these are really particularly suited to topics where social desirability might be a concern, because if you're asking someone to write a fictional story, they don't have to take ownership of what they're writing. And so these can be a suitable form of data collection for thematic analysis, as can vignettes. And these involve a series of scenarios which you give to participants and then ask them to answer some questions about those scenarios. There's a whole range of other possibilities too. You could ask participants to keep a diary, maybe about their experiences of an illness or something like that. And there's a whole range of media that could also be suitable and be appropriate for collecting data, for using for data for your TA study.
So we're going to talk a little bit in this next step about the phases that are associated with doing a reflexive thematic analysis. And we're not going to focus too much on the detail, but rather a quick introduction that emphasizes the phases as process and a process of ever increasing engagement with your data. These aren't rules and they're certainly not steps. They're different ways of thinking about your data that all contribute to helping you tell the best possible story of your data set. We're going to break down the phases and what sort of mindset you should associate with each one in the book. And we illustrate it with examples from research that we've done as well. We're obviously not going to do that here though. Remembering to do what works for you though. Some people use computer software. It's certainly not mandated that you use computer software. Some people use pen and paper. Some people use a mixture of both. So using an approach that helps rather than hinders your engagement with the data.
So thinking about the first phase of TA, this is the phase of familiarization, and this is all about getting to know your data. And we have fears that sometimes people maybe don't engage with this phase as fully as they could, that it might get a little bit overlooked. But actually, it is really important. It forms the foundations of your analysis. And there's a risk that if you only skim the data, if you don't engage fully at this point, even though it's a kind of casual engagement, there's still a risk that that could be a contributory factor in perhaps analyses that are a little bit superficial. So you might like to think of your data as being somewhat like an ocean, where actually a quick glance just doesn't do justice to how much is going on beneath the surface. So it's really important that you get to know your data well. And this starts from when you're collecting your data, but also involves you reading and engaging with your data. Once you're familiar with your data, you move on to coding. And when we're coding, we start to engage with our data in a different way. And this is more systematic, perhaps more rigorous. We're increasing our engagement and we're going deeper into the data. So we're looking at the text in this more rigorous way in this phase. We're starting to try to break the data down, and we're breaking them down into these manageable chunks of meaning. So we do this by really closely reading the data and then tagging chunks of data with a code. And we create that code. And as we work through, we create more codes, and we also allocate some of the existing codes that we're developing to other parts of our data. So at the end of this process of really rigorously reading and thinking about our data, we're left with a long list of codes that we can work with. And then we move into the initial theme generation. So we've broken our data down through coding, and what we now do is start to build it back up again and work towards themes. So we're working with the knowledge of our data through our familiarization, and we're working with our list of codes, and we're starting to develop our initial themes. But as Gareth referred to earlier, themes in reflexive thematic analysis are not just categories. We're trying to do something more than simply organize the data. And what we want to do is to create meaningful patterns that have some kind of central concept that hold them together. And that's helping us to build those themes up to tell an overall story of the data set. But at this point, our themes are very much provisional. And just to reiterate the point that what we're doing is increasingly engaging with our data as we move through these phases. And it's a reflexive process. So we as researchers are critical to this. We have our lens and we're bringing that to the data to help us to make sense of it.
So then we move into phase four, and you know, I often come across situations where I'm supporting people that have stopped at phase three, but there's still three more phases to go. And so recognizing that phase four is about developing and reviewing and refining and thinking through the implications of your themes. And that's not to suggest that the refining process isn't something which draws a whole bunch of resources from other parts of your analysis. One of the things we emphasize throughout the book is the notion that themes don't emerge, and nowhere is that more evident than in this fourth phase. Because your themes are only candidates or even prototype themes in phase three, you need to test them out, make sure that they stay where they fit in relation to the data, and telling the best possible story of the data set is so, so important. We give a number of ways you can engage in this process throughout our book. Phase five, naming and defining themes, is where the storytelling rubber really hits the road. If you can't describe your themes in quite a lot of detail, then it's likely that they're not the multifaceted conceptual meaning-based patterns that we love so much. If that's the case, then you may have to move back to your previous phases and develop things a lot more. This phase is the intersection between analysis and writing. It's where all the hard work of the earlier phases really begins to coalesce around something meaningful. And the last phase, which I think often surprises people, is the idea that the report writing process is part of analysis. By this point, your engagement in the data is at its peak, and you come to the process of writing with a huge amount of resources and existing thinking. Your theme definitions, your data extracts, your analytical thinking all come to fruition. There are a number of things you need to think about as you finish up the writing of a report, whatever that might look like, whether it be a thesis or an article or whatever. And again, we highlight things you can do to enhance your writing experience.
One of the things that we think is most useful is looking at other people's studies of TA and looking at published reports so that you can see different examples of how people have worked with data and produced their reports. So in the book, we include lots of examples of TA research that uses different methods of data collection, that comes from a different theoretical perspective, from realist through to critical realist through to constructionist. And we also discuss some of the variations of thematic analysis. And we discuss some of these and signpost to other people to give a sense of the flexibility of TA and what published reports of TA might look like.
Oops. I've jumped. So just some cautionary take-home points before we finish up with our key takeaways. Theory is fundamental. Don't be scared of theory. Everyone's using it. TA is not theoretical. It's theoretically flexible. And people often mistake the not engaging with theory for an idea of objectivity. And there's a real tendency to avoid theory. But irrespective of the background of your research and the paradigm that it's located in, locating yourself in a theoretical home is important to doing good work. It doesn't mean you have to understand all of it, just the stuff that informs your thinking, your choices, your assumptions, and your values. It's also good to be reminded that reflexive TA is just one form of thematic analysis. There are a number of things that call themselves TA, and not all of them are the same. So we point out some of the pitfalls in crossing the thematic analysis streams and give pointers about how to be clear about your method. So understanding what your method is, and if in fact it's the right analytic method for your research, is important. Then you can identify what might work with your particular method and how your methods fit into your methodology. You might not need TA. You might not need reflexive TA. Don't assume that just because you want themes that the Brown and Clark 2006 citation needs to be in your methods section.
So on this slide, we just have some of the take-home points around TA that we hope we've covered today while we've been talking. So these are around the flexibility of TA in relation to your theoretical approach, your research question, your methods of data collection. And we hope we've also given an overview of TA that gives a sense that it's a theoretically informed process of data analysis, where we're able to use the phases of TA to engage with our data in increasing depth. We hope we've also given you a sense of the importance of the researcher as very much being a part of the research process. We're really pleased to have authored this book together. We enjoyed writing it very much. Interestingly, it is actually currently out of stock on the APA website, but there are other places from which you can purchase it if you're interested. So thank you very much for your attention and for listening, and I'll hand back over to June.
Thank you, Dr. Terry. Thank you, Dr. Hayfield. Thank you once again for the presentation. And so now we have a little bit of time left, and I would like to encourage everyone who's listening in right now, submit your question, especially your research questions, because this is your opportunity to discuss with our expert authors in this field. And so I do have a question now, and so the question is, and I'll quote, I consider myself a TA researcher. I have been doing TA training for ECR and PhD students in South America. I always get asked how to address researcher bias and validation. I always talk about ontology, et cetera, but I wonder if you have any advice on how to answer these type of questions differently.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Thank you for that as a question. I think these ideas around reflexivity and bias are perhaps some of the more challenging ideas for people to get their heads around, particularly if they're coming from a very quantitative background, which is often what we're taught before we're taught qualitative approaches. And I think in terms of bias, it's just about moving into that kind of qualitative sensibility and trying to maybe manage people's expectations and highlight that it does mean a shift in thinking as we move to qualitative research, and thinking about the fact that I find it useful to think about, you know, just can we ever eliminate bias as human beings doing research with other human beings? And so instead, you know, let's embrace it and let's think about how we shape the research and think about how that can be a tool as well as how it might be limiting. And when we're working in teams, that can be really helpful to discuss those things and to bring those things out and to bring them to the fore as well. I don't know if Gareth has other things to say. I jumped straight in there.
No, that's great. And I mean, I think just to add to that and just to confirm everything that Nikki said as well, I tend to have that question quite a lot come up in my workshops and things as well. And, you know, I like to turn it back on people and say, well, I think that bias, subjectivity should be a resource. And in order to be able to use it as a resource, we need to understand what it is and who we are and everything that we bring and how it shapes the analysis to sort of cut ourselves off and block ourselves off from, you know, the things we bring, the values, our assumptions, all that sort of thing. Blocking those things off from analysis means they're unacknowledged and they will influence us irrespective. So acknowledging them and understanding them, in fact, is probably a much more scientific approach to looking at your data rather than trying to, you know, shield yourself or shield your analysis from who you are.
And it's interesting, isn't it? Because it's not just the analysis as well. Our whole interest in the topics that we research and the outlooks that we have on them are bound to be shaped by who we are. So I think it's not even just that it touches the analysis, it touches every phase of the research project as well.
Yeah.
I have no idea if that's helpful.
Thank you. So the next question, and I'll quote, thank you for the insightful presentation. I wondered what your thoughts are on involving patient public involvement in the TA analysis process.
Maybe you can go first on this one, Gareth.
So I think one of the things that we do emphasize in terms of how the method can play out is it can be done as an individual and it can be done in a way where you are engaging with you know, people as co-researchers. So it depends on the methodology that you're working with and how that patient public involvement is incorporated into your design. So it's about thinking about those things early. You know, with stakeholders and other people that are involved in processes, research that I'm involved in, I might take back information at various points to them and talk about those and ask for sort of insights or thoughts or connection to them. This isn't like the the traditional idea of member checking, where, you know, you might take transcripts back and ask them to confirm that the transcripts are in the right place. I don't think there's a place for that and that kind of work, but certainly checking in and asking for feedback on various points of the analysis at various phases can be quite useful, and it can add to the insights that are there as well.
Yeah, and I think I would say much the same. And I think there's certain points in the research when you absolutely can bring patients and public into your research, but perhaps not to validate the analysis that you've done. That's, I think, where it ends.
Thank you. The next question, do you have any recommendations for integrating reflexive TA into broader mixed method dissertation?
I have a couple of things to say, if that's okay. So I think we often think about mixed methods as being quant and qual, but you can use different qual methods altogether as well. So I just wanted to get that up front and to emphasize as part of my dissertation, my first analytical chapter was based around reflexive thematic analysis. And then I did use other qualitative methods that spun out from that initial analysis. In terms of the quant qual component, I'm not sure what you're wanting in terms of the integration of the two things, but I think what might be being talked about here is how do you work the two types of data together? And for me, I think that they need to be treated independently of one another, and their findings brought together in a way that makes sense later on, as opposed to trying to match one data set onto another, particularly with the reflexive TA. They have value in their own right, not just as a combination of two sets of methods that work together, creating a single line of thought, because I think that what they can do is reduce you down to a limited qualitative expression. And it means that one set is answerable to the other. So, and typically what happens in that is the qual data become answerable to the quant data. It's very rare to see it happen the other way around. So I think those sorts of considerations are things that I would advise, Nikki.
Yeah, I think it's interesting with mixed methods, and I think the difficulty, I'm just really going to mirror what Gareth has said, but the difficulty is in the mixing. And I think that often it's more that we do phased studies that inform each other when we're using mixed methods. I think the challenges come with the epistemologies as well. So if you're trying to move into more constructionist approaches to TA, that's much more difficult to then fit into a design that also has quantitative aspects to it. So it's also thinking about how you do that, and there's definitely challenges with it, but people do it very successfully. But I think we rarely actually mix methods. I think we use methods to inform the next method we do, and that's more, much more common than any real mixing.
And just to add to that, I'd love to see examples of constructivist and constructionist quant work. I'd love to see that, and seeing people start with that and then sort of, you know, use that as their epistemology. But often quant stuff gets aligned with positivism and post-positivist work. And so that's usually the starting point for things. But if we could see more constructionist quant work, that'd be amazing.
Thank you. The next question, are there any tips to developing richness of themes and not just jumping ideas into an obvious bucket?
Yes, definitely. Continuing to engage with your data. I think a lot of the difficulties of ending up with categories can be about, or themes that are not as rich as they could be, is about the realities of the time that we have to do our research. Mm-hmm. And any form of qualitative research is really time consuming. And so it's acknowledging that and putting that time in and allowing yourself the breathing space to really think. And I think working through those processes, whether it's, you know, obviously iteratively and recursively at times, but, you know, not thinking of the first set of themes that we have as being the ones that we're going to go with, because often maybe the first set of themes are a bit more like that. But then as we start to develop them and review them, that's when we start to see whether they're working and we can get to some deeper meaning and we can make more sense of them. And one of the reasons why writing the report or producing the report is so important is the other aspect that can sometimes help us fire is going back to the literature and helping us see how we can maybe build things up and how we can tell better stories and how we can perhaps just tweak something here and make it a bit more interesting. So I think continually working with the data is really the key, even though it's time consuming and doesn't always feel easy to do that. I'm sure Gareth has other fantastic things to add.
I mean, I think one of the things that we talk about a bit in the book is that sometimes I worry that people are not pushing the boundaries of their themes because they're concerned about how they're going to be read by someone else. And so they go for the safe and the obvious. And often that ends up being that categorical or the bucket type theme because they can easily be seen and they can be identified by somebody. When you're telling storytelling themes, there's a degree to which you're putting a bit of risk into the situation. There's a bit of skin in the game. And because it's reflexive as well, that skin is yours. You know, you're putting yourself on the line in terms of interpretation and hoping for resonance as a consequence of that engagement with your data, hoping that someone's going to read it and see some of the things you're trying to say. And so that's risky. You know, and so I think sometimes people play a safe game. And so, you know, just to emphasize what Nikki has said, engaging with it. And so you recognize that you become the expert in your data set. No one else is going to be as expert as you in that particular data set because you're the one that's doing the analysis in it. And so you can tell that great story and you can identify where theory fits in. And that's going to make it a useful and well-developed thematic construct.
And I think one of my favorite things as well is asking questions about your data and about your themes. And I think one of the things that I often use when I'm teaching students about thematic analysis is sometimes people will have a theme name and I'll say to them, so what? Or what about? And so you can sometimes just get a bit more and think a bit more about your data if you ask that kind of what about question. And if it's just a category, you probably won't be able to say much about. Whereas if you've managed to really develop something that has some meaning, you'll be able to say, well, this and this and this and this, and then you can make sure that that's reflected in your theme name as well. Sometimes theme names can really let themes down. They can look like they're a category name, but when you read the theme, there's lots more going on and it is actually really meaningful.